Windows 95, a ton of technological advancements, long file name, 32-bit architecture, plug and play, and no longer dependent on the MS-DOS.
Well, that's what Microsoft claimed and made everybody believe, but in 1998 it was proved in court by Caldera Incorporated that Windows 95 actually could run on the DOS instead.
Yes, you're right. Microsoft went great length in their marketing campaign to proclaim MS-DOS's death and that Windows 95 no longer required it to run. I remember myself reading about this claim everywhere at the time Windows 95 came along.
Ah, come on, you weren't there, were you?
Well, not there at this dancing event, no, but I was around. 16 years old and I absorbed every bit and byte I could read about the new operating system. So let's say Windows 95 no longer needed DOS to be separately installed, as it essentially bundled it underneath. There had been many discussions and a lot of analysis being done over the years if Windows 95 was indeed an individual operating system, or basically just Windows 3.11 plus Win32s, complete with a new UI on top of a bumped-up version of MS-DOS. The whole world was being overrun by a huge Windows 95 marketing campaign, and I as well was in fact eventually transitioning away from OS 2 Warp 3.0 and MS-DOS 6 because of all the new games. And although I was mostly into DOS, Windows and OS 2 at the time and barely had scratched the surface of Linux at this point, there was yet another parallel world out there I had no idea it even existed. Like Unix, which I should only get to know in the form of SGI Irix some 4 years later on my first job in 1999. And only then I got confronted myself first time ever with the concept of system emulation, namely Insignia Soft Windows 95 on my Indigo 2 workstation long before the advent of our present day virtualization. I need a new hard drive. I love old computers, I love to collect them, I love to fix them. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. When I started in the telecom industry, my employer was using SGI machines, namely Origin 200 servers, to provide for web hosting facilities. And to maintain these servers, I was attributed an SGI Indy at first. It soon showed that it was indeed too slow for, let's say, day-to-day operations by the late 90s standards, so I was eventually given an SGI Indigo 2 and later an O2 as a companion machine for my administrative duties. I remember well using Soft Windows 95 on the Indigo 2 and later the O2, and while not being top-notch performance, it was okay-ish for what it was. Insignia originally offered Soft Windows and Soft PC for Unix workstations, namely the Big Five of the time, Sun, HP, DEC, IBM and Next. Later it was ported over to the Macintosh as well. What made Soft Windows and Soft PC special was that it ran entirely in software, that means without any hardware assisted plugin boards. Co-hosting by means of plug-in CPU boards was known since the 80s, as this brought good performance. During the 90s, CPU performance has improved to the level that you could actually do software-only emulation. Still, it was quite slow as you can imagine, but from a cost point perspective, it was probably much more attractive for running the occasional DOS or Windows application. Sun was able to emulate the PC on SBOS workstations with the performance of an 8286. With the Sun PC Accelerator SX board, you got a 16MHz 486SX CPU, which bumped the performance up to new levels. On the other hand, with Soft Windows 2.0, released in 1994, Insignia claimed to reach a 486-speed emulation on contemporary hardware in software-only emulation. Now, I never used Soft Windows on the SGI Indy, though with the Indy being a child of 1993, I wondered how it would stack up with Soft Windows. At the time, my Indy ran IRIX release 6.5 and I went to install SoftWindows 95 through Software Manager. After the initial welcome greeting, with the README file popping up, I oversaw an installation conflict. I couldn't install the online registration tool as I didn't have the necessary web server support package installed. Now, this doesn't have a thing to do with licensing. It only provides a built-in registration form which runs via the local development web server. So there is no harm just not installing this part, as Insignia is defunct since years and registration is anyway leading nowhere. Coming from here, the installation eventually completed, leaving me with a new SoftWindows 95 icon in the icon catalog. Before running SoftWindows 95, I was then adding the license file to /usr/lib/softwindows/flexlm/license.dat. Now, neither of SGI nor Insignia, nor FWB Software, whom later acquired the SoftPC portfolio, still exists today, so there's no possibility to get or buy an official license today. I already had posted some license keys on my own blog years ago in order to document them before becoming lost. They float around the web in various places and are indeed confirmed working. Though, well, not official licenses. We're talking about a software product here into which the vendors have lost interest, and while I don't endorse software piracy, reenacting contemporary software for historic purposes is somewhat in a grey area. But let's be honest, how much of a commercial loss is inflicted for a piece of 30 years old software that is totally outdated and of barely any production use anymore on a day-to-day basis today, except for documenting the past? So here you have it, the license key. Now, with the license key placed in the right spot, SoftWindows will first tell me it's about to create a new virtual hard drive. 180 MB is enough. And while it's still working in the background, the browser pops up with a README file providing for additional information. Eventually, we're about to see the boot screen and then the hardware detection going on. It all looks very familiar. But it feels very sluggish, and even here on the second boot, it almost takes 3 minutes from the BIOS post until the desktop is finally loaded. My Indy has an R5K CPU with 150 MHz and 256 MB of RAM. Surely one of the most powerful machines of the Indy series, only surpassed by the 180 MHz model, but still not the high-end line of SGI workstations even by 1993 standards. Insignia claimed to provide Pentium class emulation speeds for SoftWindows 95, but that surely is not the case on the Indy. This becomes especially visible when IO intense tasks are run, like here a software installation. And when looking at the process monitor, it's immediately visible how SoftWindows 95 grabs almost all resources while still underperforming. Even rather basic things like here, bringing up Device Manager takes ages to complete. It takes somewhat 30 seconds even starting the DOS prompt, which is totally ridiculous. I didn't bother to go any further like installing something like Microsoft Office, as it was clear SoftWindows 95 was not a good match for the Indy's performance specs. So I went out to find an earlier version of SoftWindows, which I eventually found on archive.org. Hence, I removed SoftWindows 95 and tried installing SoftWindows 2.0 instead. But what a downer when I saw that Software Manager complained about unmet dependencies, owed to the fact that this earlier release of SoftWindows obviously was intended to run on a version of SGI IRIX earlier than 6.5. Now, the README didn't provide any hint whatsoever which release of IRIX SoftWindows 2.0 was intended for. So I eventually took a detour, which involved some system emulation using MAME, the Multiple Arcade Machine Emulator. This allowed me to test drive an earlier IRIX version and check the SoftWindows 2.0 compatibility with it in an emulated SGI workstation before screwing up my real Indy workstation. Check out my video about this particular venture if you'd like to learn more about emulating SGI workstations in MAME. Long story short, I eventually reinstalled this Indy with SGI IRIX 5.3 and then threw SoftWindows 2.0 at it. Here again, I added the license file to /usr/lib/softwindows2/flexlm. You'll find that as well on that blog page of mine. Upon startup, SoftWindows drops into the Windows setup right away. And as you can see here, we're talking about MS-DOS 6 and Windows 3.1. And even during this installation phase, it feels a lot more responsive already. Defrag feels to me like it should, I would say native 486 class speed. Also, Windows 3.1 feels a lot more responsive, even as I'm just doing some really basic stuff here. And there's literally nothing more stressful as a software install, so here I am installing some office tools. This really feels okay. I'll have it run in real time for a bit to give you an impression. I've done plenty of installs and this is really on par with my expectations for a 486 machine. Now, doing a benchmark inside an emulation can never be considered accurate, and I'm not trusting the CPU and disk performance numbers that Norton's system information provides me here. I personally don't think that my emulation is twice the performance of a real 486 DX266, but it definitely feels like something in between a 33 and a 60 MHz 486 class machine. To put that statement on trial, let's have a very basic look at how quickly the Office application I just installed are starting up. As a comparison, I'm adding here some screen captures I took from the compact Presario 425 that I recently fixed. Check out my other video on that repair if you're interested. The Presario 425 sports a 25MHz 486SX CPU. For better comparison, I installed the same software versions of the Office applications. So this looks a lot better and definitely a lot more usable than on SoftWindows 95.
Okay, so it works with the old junk, but what about now this SoftWindows 95? I want to see this flying.
It actually flies, I tell you. Here I'm firing up the SGI Octane 2, which comes with a 400MHz CPU and 2GB of RAM. This was really a beast by the mid to the late 90s standards and it definitely shows the potential of these machines. There were actually Octanes with dual CPU configurations, but this one here is already powerful enough to run SoftWindows 95 at decent speed. We'll be right back. there is barely any hiccups, and the software installation runs quickly. I would say we definitely got a Pentium class emulation here. The comparison shots were taken on a Pentium MMX 233MHz laptop. And here as well, let's compare the startup times of the typical Microsoft Office applications for that period. It looks fairly decent, does it? So far, you've seen everything that worked, at least when it comes to the real-world gear. I struggled though big time in getting SoftWindows to run on the MAME emulation. Although I used the same license file as on the real machine, and eventually even changing the file format, SoftWindows would always complain about failing to acquire the FlexLM license. Also, trying to enter the data manually was a fail. Eventually, I decided to give it a try and run an Indigo 2 emulation in MAME and retrying there, though I would be ultimately be stuck on this screen after the installation with the system failing to come up properly. I ultimately went back to the Indy emulation in MAME, disabling the network support and retrying again. But still, even with FlexLM obviously being able to read in the license data, it would fail to validate it. I actually saw this before reinstalling the real Indy, and there had been a fair chance that I would ultimately fail on the real gear with the license. Interestingly enough, it worked on the real machine, but just not inside the emulation. This was great, as I could pursue my investigation into SoftWindows on the real machine then. I have though to dig deeper as to why, however, FlexLM seems not to work inside the MAME emulation. So that makes already two, because also the networking support doesn't seem to work for me, at least when running on macOS. And this concludes my look into Insignia SoftWindows on SGI Irix. As we have seen, it makes a huge difference if I ran the most recent version available as compared to an earlier, and for the SGI Indy in particular, more peer correct version. And while the Indy struggled big time on SoftWindows 95, it coped quite nicely with the earlier SoftWindows 2.0 and the less resource demanding Windows 3.1. I will definitely revisit this topic as SoftWindows was also available for the Macintosh. And, rumor has it was even available for next workstations. And with that being said, I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. And before I forget, here comes my big time special thank you to everyone out there who has subscribed to this channel. I started at 0 subscribers a year ago, and today it's already over 2,100 subscribers. I would never have imagined to ever reach this high a number, but this definitely motivates me to move forward and continue. Thanks again for your support and being with me during my retro ventures. See you next time. If you check out this channel's community tab, you'll find some polls on potential upcoming videos. You're very welcome to upvote on upcoming topics or drop in new ones you'd like me to chase down.